Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, former NATO Ambassador Kurt Volker discusses President Trump's foreign affairs ideas, and we'll hear about a new organization working to bring jobs to the state. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. President Trump's recent actions on illegal immigration are spurring a debate between politicians here in Arizona. Phoenix Mayor Greg Stanton reacted yesterday to President Trump's executive action to begin the construction of a border wall. In a statement, Mayor Stanton said that the orders, quote, unleashed a divisive attack on Latinos in Phoenix and around the country. Stanton vowed that, quote, we will fight the federal government's attempt to turn the Phoenix Police Department into a mass deportation force. Now today, Phoenix City Councilman Sal DeCiccio reacted to the mayor's statement.
Mayor Stanton talks about mass deportation. Nobody's talking about that. The city of Phoenix complies with the law. Now if he wants to change the rules, then all he has to do is put a motion out there and put it on the, you know, he's the mayor. He can always put something on the agenda that moves the city of Phoenix into a sanctuary city. But his letter does nothing more than inflame the community, doesn't set out the facts as to what they are. And if he wants to move the city of Phoenix, then he needs to take action on that.
Regarding refugees, Phoenix is considered among the most welcoming cities in the country. And with in 2016, I should say, Arizona resettled more refugees in all but three states, California, Michigan, and Texas. President Trump is wasting little time in reshaping American foreign policy, from insisting that Mexico pay to build a border wall to scrapping a multi-nation trade compact. The new president is emphasizing that America's place in the world is changing. Joining us now to talk about this new direction in U.S. foreign policy is Kurt Volker, former U.S. ambassador to NATO and currently the director of ASU's McCain Institute. Good to have you back. Thanks. Been a while since you've been on. Last time you were on, we were thinking, you know, who knows? Maybe Donald Trump could be president.
Well, and turns out that's where we are.
That's where we are. Well, where are we? I mean, let's start with today's headlines. Mm-hmm. The Mexican president now is refusing to meet with the president of the United States because the president of the United States says you are going to pay for it. Mm-hmm. And if you're not going to pay for it, don't bother meeting with me. What's going on here?
I think this is a lot of pre-negotiation. You know, people used to joke about, you know, negotiating over the shape of the table before you actually have the talks that are then going to decide the issue. I think this is a little bit of back and forth trying to jostle power, show that each one is a powerful leader, kind of tease up the ability for them to make a deal. And I also think that there's another issue behind this, which I think people in Arizona are really going to understand, that the opportunities with Mexico are huge. So we don't want to lose those by building a wall or, you know, breaking up NAFTA. I think the question is, how do we actually get a negotiation where we put something into it that improves it so that we all benefit from it? How do we make a better North American area?
Well, let's talk about that aspect of the Trump diplomacy schematic, mm-hmm. if you will, because as you were saying, there are two sides here. Both sides want something, and in diplomacy, often both sides get something.
Right.
Donald Trump's idea of diplomacy seems to be very much rooted in his business acumen. I win, you lose, that's it. Are you seeing that as well?
Well, I think that's certainly what we see, this dynamic of pushing first and then saying, okay, now we have the ability to negotiate to see if we can get to a solution. Now, I'm not sure what the solution looks like. We haven't seen this in foreign policy under a Trump presidency. It's just started. It's been 5 days, 6 days, whatever it is. But what I think we have to remember is that the job of the president, the job of our diplomatic service, is to advance American interests and values. And we want to do that, and I think we're most effective when we do that, when the people we're working with want to do that too. They want to adopt values, they want to have shared interests, and we can build something better together. We are cases where we have adversaries, and so you need to push back on those adversaries. And I think what we're seeing now is a different approach to getting these negotiations going, where we have an interest, we push a little bit, and then we get into a conversation about, well, what's the final outcome? Could be that outcome is still going to be something that we're all happy about. We'll just have to see.
Well, but again, the idea of pushing against adversaries and teaming mm-hmm. with allies, he seems to be very fond of Russia, which is commonly considered an adversary. And he's pushing on NATO, he's pushing on Mexico, he's pushing on ostensible allies here. Again, what's going on?
I can only speculate here. I can't speak for the administration, obviously. But I think with Putin, every president that I can remember has started off with some kind of reset with Russia, whether it was George H.W. Bush or Clinton or George W. Bush, Obama. And a lot of that has to do with thinking that their predecessors screwed it up. And I can do better. I know these people. I can make this work. And then they gradually see that actually the problem isn't the predecessor. The problem is Russian behavior. And I think that is likely where we'll see this go again. And then there may also be a tactical element, because what we've seen so far is just changing the body language. We've been in a confrontational posture with Russia for the past few years. This is shaking things up by changing the body language. But so far, and we'll see, but we haven't seen an effort to try to say, oh, we need to offer Russia something to appease them. It's much more saying, well, let's get along and seeing how Russia reacts to that.
But if Russia goes ahead and starts being adventurous out there, you have to do or say something.
I think it's imperative that we push back, because that's the language that Russia understands. Putin really does push hard with force, and he wants to see how others react. I think we need to show reaction to that. But there was an interesting thing, if you remember this about a week ago, where Putin said something about nuclear weapons and they have the best nuclear arsenal in the world. And I guess it was then President Trump tweeted back saying, well, we're going to be modernizing our nuclear arsenal and ours is the best in the world. And since then, we haven't heard a thing about it.
Yeah. There's so many different avenues to go there, but there is some concern that the relationship between President Trump and Russia, just in general, maybe some oligarchs over there, maybe Putin himself, there's something going on there that may not be healthy for the rest of us, but is certainly good for Donald Trump. Is that a valid concern? The relationship, his personal relationship with Russia, is that a valid concern?
Well, I don't want to speculate about it because I really don't know what it is. We've seen some of these reports and then these reports are debunked and I just don't want to go there. But what I would say is that the relationship between the U.S. and Russia is terribly important. Russia has been a very bad actor. We can tick off all the things that they've done over the last several years, invading Georgia, invading Ukraine, annexing territory, threatening nuclear use, all of that stuff. And what I think we are looking at is a question of tactics. How do we address that Russia so that we can change that behavior or contain that behavior and at the same time avoid getting into a confrontation? And I think every president has started with tactics of trying to reach out, and every president so far has ended up with tactics saying we got to push back. I think we're just at the beginning of a phase here.
What about the phase with China? The TPP, that trade deal, multinational trade deal, formally abandoned by the U.S. This was a free trade zone for 40% of the world economy. Critics are saying, we leave that 12-nation deal, and China just steps right into a huge vacuum. Do they have a point?
There is a point to that, because this was the framework that we had been working with. That it was to be a pact with countries that are around China, that feel a little bit concerned about China. But it doesn't mean it's the only thing that we can do. It was the framework we were working with. There are specific implications of it, about all the issues that people have talked about with trade. We clearly don't have the political support behind pursuing this right now after President Trump's election. So I think there is a risk that China does sort of feel they can step in, flex its muscles a little bit. But at the same time, what we have to see is what replaces it. What replaces that framework of TPP as the U.S. engagement with all these countries in Asia who desperately want that engagement?
But we also hear critics saying that with the U.S. pulling out of this deal, which has been in the works for a long time, the U.S. is seen as somewhat unreliable. And if they're unreliable, if we are unreliable in this, we could be unreliable in other areas as well.
Yeah, it's interesting because I think we've seen the same thing with Europe as well. We've been negotiating this transatlantic trade investment partnership. That's likely not to go anywhere either. The Europeans have soured on it also. We just have a new president and a new policy, and I think countries are trying to figure out how do they connect with that. I can't tell you the number of conversations I've had with ambassadors or foreign ministries from other countries where they are trying to connect to the new administration and still not even knowing who to call or how to do that.
Yes, and we're also hearing reports that there's a lot of turnover going on in the diplomatic corps, and some of the longtime folks mm-hmm. are saying, I'm out of here, I don't want to deal with this, and it's getting difficult to replace them. What is that?
Well, there, I have to say, coming out of the Foreign Service and knowing that aspect of it, my view is that, look, we have an elected president. It is our duty as Foreign Service officers and career government employees to serve the president and make the best out of it that we can. And then beyond being a Foreign Service officer, as an American, he's now been elected the president. We have to want him to be successful.
As far as the new UN ambassador, the U.S. ambassador to the UN, Nikki Haley, no diplomatic experience mm-hmm. there. I believe that Tillerson, Secretary of State, no diplomatic mm-hmm. experience there. Does that concern you?
Well, it doesn't. And in particular, if you take Tillerson, he has enormous business leadership experience, CEO of one of the largest companies in the world, very successful, and enormous international experience. So he wasn't making foreign policy. He was actually understanding and engaging with and dealing with very complex problems around the world and some very unsavory characters and figuring out how to deal with them. So I think he brings a wealth of experience into this. Nikki Haley, she doesn't have the foreign affairs experience, as you say, but she has a tremendous personal narrative, and she has been an elected and successful politician in the United States and can reflect what the people in this country believe and feel, which is an important message to carry at the UN. And then in diplomacy, as in all of these jobs, we have career professionals who are there staffing all of these things, the deputy ambassador at the United Nations, the whole Foreign Service underneath the Secretary of State. We have a very strong career foreign policy expertise. So it's been the nature of our system, whether it's under Obama or under President Trump, we bring in outside political leadership and staff it with career professionals.
As far as General James Mattis, Defense Secretary, some are concerned, again, civilian control of the military kind of takes a mm-hmm. holiday with this appointment. What do you think?
Well, I think that Mattis is almost a unique figure, as George Marshall was. He has been out of the military. He's a hero within the military. He's battle-hardened war experience. We do face a very strong threat with ISIS. And he's also a scholar as well and very well regarded as an intellectual coming out of the military at the same time. And if you saw the votes in the Senate and the hearing in the Senate, he has tremendous support for both leadership of the Pentagon and this war effort that we're in against ISIS.
And yet his boss, all their bosses, is mm-hmm. Donald Trump. Is what's happening in America with Donald mm-hmm. Trump and the idea that everyone seems to want a border now, everyone seems to want a little bit of a fence, everyone seems to want their own country back, quote unquote. Is that happening in Europe? Is that happening all over the world?
Well, it's a different trend. I wouldn't describe it quite that way, the border and the fence and all. What I would say is that people around the world, you see it in the UK with the Brexit vote, the Netherlands with the far-right party leading those polls, France, Germany, Sweden, Poland, Hungary, that's all over Europe. What you see is that people feel that the current elites, the people who have been in power running politics, running countries for decades, aren't responsive and aren't dealing with worries that people have. Some of those worries are in immigration. Some of them are in economics. Some of them are on globalization. Some of them are on social issues. But you have this frustration in publics that the elites they have aren't dealing with the challenges that they face today. That's where the people from the far-right parties like Marine Le Pen in France or the Alternative for Deutschland in Germany, that's where they're getting their wind in their sails from by appealing to those people. The challenge is how do more mainstream politicians with more realistic solutions to problems address those same frustrated voters.
Are they going to have a voice, these mainstream politicians?
Some are getting squeezed out. In the case of the Netherlands, they've banded together and say even if Geert Wilders gets the single largest number of votes in parliament, they will still be the ones to form a government. They won't work with him. In the case of the UK, Theresa May is now the leader of the Conservative mm-hmm. Party, the UK coming to Washington tomorrow. She is both carrying forward the will of the voters in the UK on the referendum, but she's trying to also bring this back into mainstream politics. Angela Merkel, she's in a tough spot in Germany, and she is losing some ground with public opinion, but still so far has the the political institutional machinery in place to probably get reelected this fall.
It's interesting, real quickly, Theresa May was quoted as saying that the UK and America, we will rediscover our confidence together. That's interesting. I mean, you have a president of the United States using carnage, saying the American dream is dead. She's saying we have no, you know, we need to rediscover our confidence. Interesting times.
It is interesting times. What I would say about that is I think what Trump is trying to get at is a feeling that things haven't gone well. We've been overextended, overengaged. Things haven't gone well. The world is worse off than it was. And then we've been pulling back from it as well. He's trying to tell people we can reengage, and the question is how. And we want to do it in a way that actually works for the United States. Now, you know, we'll see, because you know, we're just the early days, and anything can happen. But I think there is something behind what she's saying.
All right. Very good. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it. And coming up next on Arizona Horizon, we'll learn about a new group that's looking for better ways to grow Arizona's economy.
We're in the middle of rather a drama.
I've been thinking about the circumstances of the crime and the nature of love.
It's romantic, is it? Isn't it?
Seems to me as if the answer is right in front of me.
I love.
I'm a high functioning sociopath.
But I've gotta stay true.
You are being irrational.
My morals got me all my.
Need to go.
I'm begging you, please.
Will you do a blood test?
No.
You wanna hit me now?
I don't know what this is, but you got me good, just like you do.
Do you think that makes me a wicked woman, sister?
Will the prisoner rise?
There is only one thing
I would like.
Pain.
Sex.
Heartbreak.
Or love. Oh, yummy.
Stop it!
Papa? Is everything all right in there?
Arizona Center for Economic Progress is a coalition of state community leaders with a common goal to grow the state's economy by creating a solid education system and keeping an eye on the budget. Former state lawmaker David Lujan is the director of the new coalition. Good to see you again. Thanks
good
for joining us.
Thanks.
How you been?
I'm doing well.
Haven't seen you in the legislature. It's been a while since you've been down there. Yeah.
Everything looks the same?
It does. The Arizona Center for Economic Progress. What are we talking about here?
We are an organization that is going to be advocating for the conditions to create better jobs and better economic opportunities for all Arizonans. And we think the timing could not be more important. Median family income in Arizona has dropped by $7,000 since 2009. One in four Arizona children live in poverty. So there's a lot of Arizonans that are hurting. So what are those conditions that are going to lift up the economic opportunities? That's what we're going to be advocating for.
All right. Let's ask the question. What are the conditions that are going to lift up the Arizona economy?
Well, let's look at what's the one economic tool that we seem to have been using year after year since 1990, and that is cutting taxes. That's been seems to be the one strategy that we've had in Arizona. And but we want to look at what are the other strategies? What are things like investing in K-12 education, making college affordable, investing in infrastructure and roads? Those are the things. You know, we all like low taxes, but you know, Arizonans want to also see those things that are going to help them to succeed, and those are the things we're going to advocate for.
So when your group calls for a balanced tax, define balance.
Well, I think it's a tax that's going to be able to support the services that Arizonans expect to see. So we want to have a quality public education system, like I said. We want to, you know, we have had more cuts to our public education system than any state in the country since 2008. Same goes with higher education. So what are those investments that we need to be making so that we can be having good quality education and building that strong workforce.
So, and again, the word balanced is used as far as budget policies. You're calling for balanced budget policies. Again, balance it for us.
Yeah, well, I think it's, you know, right. What we've had since 1990 is, we've cut taxes every single year. So we want to have a little bit of balance on the other side in terms of, let's not just look at what are the, you know, we all want low taxes, but, you know, what are the investments that we should be making to grow our economy?
Infrastructure, robust infrastructure, is that the most pressing? Was that got to be one of the most pressing needs?
Got to be. You know, last year, the Auditor General's Office came out with a report that said our roads, we're going to need $62 billion over the next 25 years to keep up our roads where they need to be. And in that same report, they cited the Society of Civil Engineers that said that our road conditions now cost Arizonans $1.5 billion a year in vehicle repairs because of the conditions. So when we talk about creating the conditions to lift up all Arizonans, when we're costing Arizonans in vehicle repairs, we should be investing in creating jobs rather than letting our roads get to that kind of condition.
Sounds like this is all long-term vision stuff. Are there shorter angles?
Yeah, we're very much a long-term focus. You know, being in the legislature for a number of years, I saw that, you know, it just seems like every economic strategy that we have is, you know, what are we going to do for our next election? You know, what's this thing we can do for this cycle? And we don't really have that long-term focus. So we're very much going to be pursuing that long-term focus. But in terms of short-term goals, one of the things I would say is we need to stop draining the revenues so that we can invest in those other things that are going to create jobs. And so, like I said, we've cut taxes every year since 1990. It's resulted in over $2 billion less in revenue that we could have today to be investing in those priorities that really will help to grow our economy. So I would say that would be the first thing we should look at, is let's stop draining the revenues so that we have the money to invest.
And yet I know that there are some viewers, and certainly the conservative and Republican lawmakers that appear on the show, will say that's $2 billion that went back into the pockets of Arizona residents who use that money to stimulate the economy. Are they wrong?
Well, you know, we've cut taxes, like I said, every year since 1990. So, and every year, I think if you were to go and take a soundbite of whatever legislator or governor was advocating for that, they're going to say, you know, this is going to be, you know, something that's going to bring all these jobs and it's going to really be a boost to our economy. So if we've been doing that every year since 1990, we should have the most prosperous economy and jobs and corporate headquarters here. And we aren't seeing that. And I think people are starting to see that in Arizona. You know, Alliance Bank last year did a CEO survey of the 400 of the top CEOs around Arizona, asking what's the number one thing state government can do to create and improve our business environment. The answers in that poll were education, education, education. The number one thing that state government can do would be invest in public education, improve the quality of our workforce. So those are the other strategies I think that we want to start looking at.
Well, and these are strategies, and we hear this, and yet as far as the legislature is concerned, you've been down there. You were once a lawmaker. You know how it works. It's getting more attention. There are certainly more, it's more of a priority down there, but we're still in the 40s as far as education per pupil funding. How do you get these ideas from your group past, you know, the white paper stage and into action?
You know, I think an organization like ours, the Arizona Center for Economic Progress, can, one, build coalitions. We launched the center on January 5th, and we had an event where we brought organizations from all over the state. And there were organizations that were typically not in the room together. We had not only your education advocacy groups, but you had your chambers of commerce, your business development groups, environmental groups, all recognize that we have to do something different to grow the economy. So I think it's building those coalitions. But it's also, I think, we can tell the stories. And I'm not talking about just anecdotal stories. I'm talking about the big picture stories about how these cuts over the years are really impacting our economy and how we should be taking a different route to grow and create jobs.
And I know your organization, you look to have a diverse group of analysts. Who decides who gets to analyze for your group?
In terms of analyzing, I think you're talking about, you know, just building those coalitions.
Yes.
Well, I think Arizona gets to decide. I, you know, what I have seen as we've started the work for this is there's a lot of people a lot of groups that are very interested in being part of this, and a lot of people see that we have to take a different direction when it comes to our economy in this state. And so I think people, you know, of these diverse groups are coming together on their own. I don't think we need to decide. I think people are just making those decisions themselves.
So as far as the list of legislative priorities, give me the top. What's at the top there? And again, how do you plan on getting it past lawmakers and into action?
Well, I don't think we don't have a legislative agenda this session. We're very much a long-term focus in terms of creating those conditions. And I think they're the ones that I've already said, investing in K-12 education, higher education, infrastructure. I would point to, though, for this session, looking at some of those decisions that maybe are not in the long term. And I'll give you an example. Last year, the Department of Revenue laid off 52 tax collectors and auditors. And so we're not talking about having to raise taxes in that situation. The Department of Revenue's own report says that each auditor brings in between $1 to $2 million a year. So that's $52 million in revenue that is owed to the state. So we want to point out things like that in terms of those long-term decisions that we should really be focusing on so that we've got the resources to invest in our priorities.
All right. Good to have you here.
Yeah,
thanks for
good
joining.
To be back.
Good to see you again.
Thank you.
And Friday on Arizona Horizon, it's the Journalists Roundtable. County recorders across the state accuse the Secretary of State's office of being ineffective and disrespectful, and Republican lawmakers want to change what they call an out-of-control Board of Regents. That's on the next Journalists Roundtable. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.